Welcome to Redefining Medicine, an intimate and personalized program that illustrates a different side of the practice of medicine. Our in-depth conversations will focus on mentors and motivators who are consistently reshaping, redefining, and rediscovering the field of medical healthcare. I would like to welcome Dr. Joel Kahn, a renowned plant-based preventative cardiologist and academic who currently serves as a clinical professor of medicine. Consistently considered one of the nation's top doctors, Dr. Kahn has published several best-selling books surrounding holistic heart health and is a frequent guest on national TV, radio, and podcasts. Thank you so much, Dr. Kahn, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me talk a little about medicine.
So what initially motivated you to study medicine?
You know, I didn't fill out a psychological evaluation and NASCAR driver here and cardiologist here, but I did have a heart murmur as a child, like from birth. So I had to see a pediatric cardiologist. I had a heart cath when I was 1 year old, and wow. I actually don't remember. And none of that proved to be any big deal. It was a little defect that closed. But I think that had an influence. And I've got a great picture of my pediatric cardiologist, Dr. Green, examining me in a crib when I was about two, and he's stethoscope in one hand, cigarette in the other.
Oh my goodness, about
the early 1960s before the Surgeon General report came out. So that didn't influence me. I never smoked, but just the interest in the heart. So if you would have asked me if I was 14, 15, 16, I would have said cardiologist, although there were no physicians in our family.
Were you interested in your science classes growing up?
I had a great high school science teacher that was an influence. And then, really, life is funny about boxes you check or things you turn up to. I was going to go, in the day when I was applying for university application, you didn't apply to 100 places. I lived in Detroit. Ann Arbor was 45 minutes up the road, and I filled out one application to be an undergraduate at the University of Michigan, but there was a little box. And the box said, are you interested in the integrated medicine, pre-medicine program called Interflex? I had no idea what that was, but there was no fee to check the box. I checked the box, got more information. And it turns out there was a program where in 6 years you could do the combined situation. It was about 3-4 years old. It was 50 students. It really was, as I learned, an awesome program. And I had to go through some psychological interviews and testing. And then age 17, I got a letter of acceptance to medical school. So really didn't, I was locked in pretty early. Yeah. And the program was interesting because they did worry that maybe you picked a career early that wasn't right for you. So the first year as a 18-year-old, you had to spend 6 weeks in some medical setting. I ended up matching with a hospital in suburban Detroit that was on the other side of town. I didn't really know, and I ended up living there for 6 weeks. And it was like the show ER before there was a show, just all night long running around, operating, pathology, ER, and it just clicked. So really was an early, easy decision for me.
Was there ever a time that you thought you would be doing something else?
Every day. And I do about 10 things a day, of which medicine is the biggest portion. But I grew up in a retail business that was vibrant. And that's what I did for summer jobs, was either hauling trash or driving high-lows or occasionally on the sales floor. I use all those skills to this very day.
We might have to get back to that one. So you graduated from medical school. And
yes, I did.
You studied.
See it probably for your podcast. Grabbed the summa cum laude, which was important from med school, University of Michigan, because we were, by that point, in the last year, we were integrated with the other 250 students, so nearly 300. And there was a little competition between the preemies, as we were called, because we were admitted early. We never took the MCATs, for example, and the driven hardcore biochemistry majors and such. So it was a good moment for the program that I grabbed that award. But I wanted very briefly to go on to a path to cardiology, which means internal medicine. I had done rotations at Harvard hospitals as a medical student. And I was going to Harvard until the day, and in the old days, there'd be 300 people in a bar, and you'd one by one open an envelope on the stage and announce where you matched, and it said University of Michigan Ann Arbor. So I wasn't going
destined
anywhere. Apparently, I didn't make
such
an amazing impression on those crimson Harvard physicians. But actually turned out great. The internal medicine program in Ann Arbor and chief of medicine, Dr. William Kelly, world famous, tough guy. It was the old days of tough medicine, and you know, men were men and there were no other genders. It was a great 3 years of training, and happened to be also a great cardiology program. Anybody know the name Eric Topol? I was there the day Eric Topol arrived from his fellowship with his TPA that he revolutionized cardiology with in the mid-80s, and Dr. Bill O'Neill was blasting open arteries with balloons. And it was just a wonderful time. Fred Marotti, a world-famous electrophysiologist, arrived then during my residency. And, you know, so I was hanging around the cath lab when I should have been probably studying, you know, immunology or allergy, but I knew what I wanted to do. And anyway, so just, again, this cycle comes up and you need a cardiology fellowship. It has to be Harvard. It has to be Harvard. This time I was able to open the envelope in my home, I think it came, and it said University of Texas Southwestern in Dallas. So it was a top 10 program, Parkland Hospital, Dr. James Willerson, as it came to be, a remarkable and amazing man who now runs the entire Texas Heart Institute and all that stuff in Houston as he moved on, but moved down, and it proved to be an amazing and incredible 3 years, you know, just somebody guiding me. It was a little different. It wasn't a cath lab program. There was cath, but it was just intensive training and biochemical training and pathways. I did nuclear, but one more stop in Kansas City to learn how to open arteries with balloons. And 1990, ended up back in a large, large private practice in Ann Arbor, Michigan, which was not the plan, but just the way it was supposed to be in Orlando or Ocala after dozens of interviews in every practice in that area. That's what I wanted to be, was a citrus cardiologist. But Ann Arbor called me back, and I started practicing there, and it turned out to be, although I've moved down the road back to Detroit now, it was all a good thing. There's all kinds of side stories about how I ended up being a weird cardiologist, the weird cardiologist.
And why do you call yourself a weird cardiologist?
Well, in my city, in my state, one, I've been vegan for 40 years. No, I did that before I was a cardiologist.
What inspired you to become vegan?
Okay, so that's a side story, okay. But it now is a medical story. So I grew up in a home where we kept kosher, and I always thought for a second before I ate, is there pork, is there cheese and pork? I wasn't, you know, devoutly perfect on it, but it was pretty good. And first day undergrad, Ann Arbor dormitory cafeteria, transformed me out of the grossness of everything but the salad bar. And I was with a very cute girlfriend of the moment who now has been my wife for 36 years, so we decided together we're going to do the salad bar thing out of survival. And within a couple of years, I started reading some books to explore a little more about this diet. But every time, everywhere I've trained, Kansas City, which is the barbecue sauce capital of the world, meant, you know, it was tough. Dallas, which is the barbecue, O'Brien's Smoky Barbecue House is right outside Parkland Memorial Hospital. It's where all meetings are held for University of Texas Southwestern, at least at that time. I ate every baked bean they have, and that was the end of my menu. So it's always been a bit of a, you know, at a time that there wasn't a wealth of medical data. I mean, Dr. Oz just announced this week that 2017 is the year of veganism in medicine, and but that was, you know, 30 years after I was training as a plant-based physician. And then the data came out. We can talk about the data, but it became really the core. So I'm weird because it's been the core of my practice. Even while I was in the cath lab, I would give them recipes how to make a kale smoothie while they were getting their stent, and tell them about blenders.
Are most of your patients compliant with that?
They've made changes. Some have made little changes that hopefully still benefit them, and a substantial number, you know, are doing majority of it, and a large number are doing all of it. You know, I teach them the science, and now that's easier than ever, and I see the benefits. We can talk about what's evolved in Detroit, because we have a gigantic teaching patient group on that. And we're in that reason. Nutrition led me to be interested in nutrition in a capsule, so supplements, and I just started reading, probably many people will know of Life Extension, a Fort Lauderdale-based vitamin company. Somewhere I saw that magazine 10, 12 years ago. I was already in practice for quite a while, but I subscribed and was fascinated every month when it came, and was kind of experimenting like a chemistry kit, which I loved to do as a kid at home, was blow things up in the basement. So
Your poor mother.
I'd never made my own vitamins, but I was, you know, reading and learning. And then really about 5 years ago, I heard about this program. Dr. Pamela Smith is in Detroit, had an opportunity to hear about it and had not, and decided, you know, this is what I need. Is I've always been a faculty at least one medical school. Right now I'm faculty at two, and I wanted to not, you know, completely deviate off into, you know, something that, not so much my peers and all, but for my own edification, if I could do this and be inside a university setting. So I had the nutrition science pretty down. I added supplements and metabolic pathways, detoxification, and tried to merge that into private practice. So, and then finally, about a year and a half ago, I opened my own clinic, which is kind of the destiny that this path has taken me to. And so I'm a solo practitioner without a hospital practice, and I don't take insurance. I got one employee, but I am the happiest cardiologist, you know, by far. I mean, both because of the results, the impact, the personal nature of my practice, the diversity. I haven't given up what I learned all those years. I just have the biggest toolbox of anybody in town, pretty much. Always been into, yoga, mind, body, so that always has been a little bit of what I've brought up at times. But, you know, it's really fun because not one size fits all. You know, prescription drugs clearly help people and have a role, and I don't deny that. I don't write the books about statin disasters, but I'm certainly very mindful and very often will try and, God forbid, teach them how to eat better to lower their cholesterol, and, you know, we have a lot of fun with that.
Who is your typical patient?
A whole diversity. I brought a good number of my old patients, because I'd been doing this for 25 years before I transitioned, and a good number, but surprisingly not that many. The financial arrangement puzzled many of them. My statement that I wouldn't necessarily be their hospital cardiologist, I mean, I was on staff at 8 hospitals, and there were some weekends. It was just insane about 2 years ago, so I wasn't going to continue that. It was my own integrative healthcare program for me was to say it was time to give up the cath lab. I may have put in 10,000, 15,000 stents, and I've been radiated for long periods of time. It was just time to pass the baton on to many people that I had trained. My hospital, Beaumont Hospital, has a gigantic cardiology training program, and most of the cardiologists in town, I've had some piece of training them over the years. So, you know, I knew I could easily transition and pass it on and know who to trust. So that was it. And then, so they're there and they're wonderful and they're loyal and I'm very grateful for them. And they can have any range of disease. But I attract a lot of people that don't want standard therapy. I don't advertise that I don't, you know, I reject standard therapy. They don't want a statin. They'd like to get off pills. Well, that's an honorable goal. Some can, some can't, but they want to get off pills. A lot of plant-based people that just, you know, don't get a lot of support. They read the books, they do the research, they bring papers to the cardiologists, and they get laughed off. You know, that never worked. The common statement is there's no such thing as heart disease reversal. Heart disease reversal is a joke. I've never seen it. Of course, you've never seen it. You've never tried it. And
do you have a success story you can share?
Yeah, I will. But I just got to say, to offend everybody, the president of the American College of Cardiology last year was Dr. Kim Williams, who's chief of cardiology at Northwestern. He's got a named chair of cardiology. I'm blanking on the, doesn't matter. You know, very prominent guy, you know, was the leading cardiologist for a year in the United States. And he's got a quote because he's been about a dozen-year vegan. Dropped his cholesterol 100 points, lost 40 pounds, blood pressure came under control. He did it for him, and he started teaching patients, got a lot of negative feedback at University of Chicago and Northwestern and such. At any rate, he had a quote last year, there's only two kind of cardiologists, vegan cardiologists and those that have simply never read the literature. And that's a little strong of a statement, and he said it quietly, and then it got blasted all over the world. It's a meme that everybody shares on Instagram and such. But I do believe if a reasonable scientific argument has no argument. I mean, there's no data there. There's talk about heart disease reversal, you're only at the salad bar. So life took me 40 years back to the salad bar for different reasons. Yeah, patient example, and this will lead to, I think, an interesting topic for people listening. I was about to say, I didn't like I had billboards up that I'm the plant-based cardiologist. It's actually not true. A vegetarian group in Michigan put up for 5 years billboards all over the city, airport, industrial areas, NBA players who were vegan, like John and Sally, some children who were vegan, but I was on one of their billboards for years. It said, beat heart disease, cancer, diabetes, eat vegan. So I was not in one zone, but a man called me 3 years ago, and he said, I live in Detroit, I'm not your heart patient, but I am a heart patient, I'm not yours, and I adopted Dr. Esselstyn's plant-based diet for heart disease reversal a year ago when I was in Cleveland Clinic, one day from bypass surgery, and somebody said they had a program using natural nutritional therapy. I checked myself out. I've had an amazing year. I've lost 50 pounds. Cholesterol's down 100 points. I used to get angina playing tennis. I play tennis 3 hours. I've never had a stent, never had a bypass. My stress test was bad. Now my stress test is good. But I'm lonely because I eat a strange diet and Thanksgiving and Christmas and New Year's and my family and my wife, and they all think I've, you know, they see the results, but they still give me grief. Can we make a support group? That's where I'm going. So Paul Chatelain said that. I said, absolutely. We've got 20 people in my practice. You, we have a quarterly support group. Maybe we can do a potluck. We took a little room in my hospital without any advertising. 150 people showed up. On a winter day, horrible driving. I have no idea where they came from. The vegan hotline was out. And then the next month, 200 people showed up, and the hospital threw us out. And they said, you know, you're talking about anti-bypass, you're talking anti-stent, you've got a program the hospital hasn't supervised. You know, you're talking about salad and vegetables and beans. This is bad stuff. We can't have it in our hospital. It's really, they threw us out. So we took over a high school auditorium. There's now 3,500 members. It's the world's largest grassroots, no funding, terribly shaky, but dynamic plant. It's called Plant-Based Nutrition Support Group, or PBNSG.org. Amazing website. All over the world, dietitians, chefs, and others have contributed materials. And we have a monthly meeting. Paul Chatelain runs it. I provide a few medical comments. A chairman of the department, a chef, PharmDs and others that can contribute something to the knowledge that these people have. So it's been an incredible path that I didn't expect. It's, you know, not an economic one. We haven't figured out an economic. You know, we need a monthly membership or something so we can support ourselves, so we struggle along. But any city, any group can do it. So fun, you know, addition to my practice. I didn't expect. Great success story. And there's, if you want more, I'll give you more, but that's a good one. Great, real short type 2 diabetes case. We have a local folk hero in Detroit, 49-year-old man named Mark Ramirez. He played for the University of Michigan. He played 4 years with Harbaugh. Has a bunch of Rose Bowl visits, and I think a few Rose Bowl wins on his hand, 86 to 90. I was away from Ann Arbor during those years, so I never knew Mark, but was a big, strapping, buffed guy. But 10 years later, as an executive in the communications business, had gained 40, 50 pounds, like a lot of athletes and a lot of people. Blood sugar was up, and he was told he was an adult diabetic at about age 31, 32. It freaked him out because he's Latino, and there's a high frequency of adult diabetes in Latinos. Plus, his mother was on dialysis. His brother had a heart attack. Another brother had had a leg amputated from diabetes. I think his sister had bad retinopathy from diabetes. And you know, he was starting to have erectile dysfunction. And for the next 12 years, he took first his one pill, then his four pills, then his insulin, then his statin, then his Viagra. He was on 8-9 medicines. And somebody 5 years ago handed him a DVD called Forks Over Knives. And he had never, through all his travails, had anybody really tell him there's a chance that adult diabetes could be reversible by altering your diet. You can say dramatically, but the food he eats is amazing. It's just different than what he was eating. I mean, he, of course, probably had met dietitians and ADA recommendations. There still was heavy oils and cheese and meat. Overnight, his wife Kim and him said, we're doing this, and 3 months later, he was off of all medicines. That's 5 years now. He's 40 pounds down. His cholesterol's great. He shares his labs on various blogs. He's become a consultant to the University of Michigan alumni, because many of these football players are struggling with weight and blood sugar. All you got to do is give them a copy of Forks Over Knives, and they're pretty much on their way. You know, a remarkable guy, and he now has actually set up a second patient support group about 25 miles away from where we meet, not competitive, just geographically. He was driven to do that, and it's called chickpeaandbean.org. And so he's healing people there, we're healing people there. So really, we have an unlimited number of examples of people, a podiatrist I grew up with who simply started reading this Facebook page we have for plant-based nutrition support group. He's 110 pounds lighter by simply just saying, you know, we post scientific studies, we post, you know, exceptional case studies like we're talking about. And, you know, the power of natural medicine, basically nutritional medicine, and throw in exercise. And I'm a big supplement guy. There's place for all of these. But amazing resurgence of, quote-unquote, natural health going on in Detroit, based out of a couple of very energetic people and, you know, a little push I gave, but I don't take credit for the growth of this thing. I've been off doing my own crazy cardiology and now restauranteuring, but so.
Tell us a little about green space.
Okay, another thing, he's really crazy. you know, so I was deep in the nutrition world from this very long plant-based, and, you know, the heroes in my life, Dr. Dean Ornish, published scientific peer-reviewed, you know, and still putting out, he's early 60s, so he was doing this research when he was 24, that became world famous. Dr. Caldwell Esselstyn, the Cleveland Clinic, who's the physician that helped Paul Chatelain avoid bypass surgery. Dr. Neil Barnard, PCRM.org, runs an amazing scientific conference every June or July in Washington, D.C. on nutrition, brings in world-class speakers. I mean, it says, food may be just food, but you can get very academic about it, and he brings those academicians in from all over the world. Amazing kind of conference. And so fortunately, I'm able to say I've become friendly with all of them and integrated. This was so much of my life while I was practicing, and my patients either did it or didn't, but they knew it was an option, and that alone, I can't tell you how many times to this day I see people that have had stents and bypass and valve replacements and strokes and leg stents, and first conversation they've ever had was my telling them, you know, do you know what Ornish, Esselstyn, Barnard, McDougall, Forks Over Knives, Plan Pure Nation, I give a quiz, can you recognize any of these words? And it's like I'm speaking a foreign language. I said, we got hope here because there's so much you can do. You know, by next week, you're on your path. So I was so immersed in it that my oldest son, Daniel, with an MBA and totally bored as an accountant, it clearly wasn't his. Accountants are wonderful people, and I honor their profession, but, you know, either you are or you aren't. And he wanted energy. He wanted, you know, movement and energy. And we started looking at small little franchises and juice bars, and I thought it would be cool to be in that business. And then a restaurant came up in a suburb of Detroit that with a liquor license, tiny, great town, kind of like West Hollywood, kind of like East Village of New York, but Detroit's equivalent, Ferndale, Michigan. And we took over the lease, really wasn't an expensive prospect at that point. And then as we started to do some minor revisions, we realized this is a 70-year-old building that nobody has put a nickel in, and it was just literally fleas and bugs and dead animals, and this was a restaurant before we took it over. So we gutted it, and we were in the middle of transitioning into a very cool upscale liquor license. And we made a decision, vegan, upscale, artisanal restaurant, when the store next door, the owner died, and there was, you know, we had the opportunity to triple the space, and we did that after way too much tequila. And so we opened about a year and a quarter ago, Green Space Cafe. It's 140 seat, which is a big restaurant, 25 seat bar, you know, non-GMO, plant-based, gourmet, family-friendly, kick-ass place. It's really between New York and L.A. There's nothing like it. And the community's really responded to it because, you know, it's always nice to eat something different, even if it's once a month. You know, so we become that place that even the heavy steak eaters might go to for a little detox at the bar. You can have organic
vodka
with, you know, kale juice. We have turmeric infused vodkas and corianders. Yeah, we have a little like pharmacy of the joy of alcohol if you're into it. Of course, many non-alcoholic things. So very fun place.
Where did you find your chef?
Chef was local and he's wonderful. Griffin Wilson is young and he's an up and coming. It's not yet a chef driven like the show Chopped or something, but he's doing a great job and you know, he's rotating the menu. So I have no skills. I know how to bus tables. My girlfriend wife, she was bussing tables in high school. So we're very good at bussing tables again. People, I actually went to the Detroit Auto Show has a charity event. I didn't know it was the largest single charity event in the world in January, and I went in my black tie and made my circles, but I came back to the restaurant 2 weeks ago Friday, and it was popping, it was hopping, it was busy. So I ended up bussing tables in my tuxedo. People thought that was very classy. They know I'm a heart doctor already, so they don't know why the heck I'm taking dirty, plates. You got to do what you got to do. And, it's really become busy. Friday, Saturday night, we've had nights we've served 400 to 500 people. I mean, it's a lot for a restaurant. So, and it's not, we have no fryers. There's no fried food. It's a very sprouts on everything. So very proud of it all. We're not opening more of them unless somebody out there has a whole lot of extra cash. They say, how do you make a small fortune in the restaurant business? You start with a large fortune. So
it's how much time do you spend there?
Yeah, so I've structured my integrative cardiology practice. It's pretty much 9 to 5, and I can be there by 5:30. I just finished my fourth book, which will be published in 2017. I wrote it all at my bar standing because I never sit except for occasional interviews. I wrote it standing during the month of December. So I'm there just circulating, come back, write another, few pages. And that's what I often do, answer patient
and
emails.
And what is the name of your new book?
The Plant-Based Solution. It'll be out. It's going through, unfortunately, additional edits because I just got all those back and it's pulled my
hair out. A lot of red lines.
Pulled my hair out for another month. But it's got a bunch of restaurant recipes in it, too. But it goes, there's a wonderful book, if nobody's read, called How Not to Die by Dr. Michael Greger.
Had the opportunity to interview Dr. Greger
last month. Oh, you did? Yeah. Good. Yeah. He's wonderful, and we've spoken together. He's been at our plant-based group. He's eaten at Green Space. That's a big book.
And
he sold 250,000 of them, so it's been a phenomenon that a book with so much science and so much diversity from autoimmune to cardiac to aging to whatever perspective the science of plant-based nutrition is there. Mine you can read on vacation because that's how I like it. It's simpler. But there's a place for both of them, God knows. I should only be as successful as Dr. Kirk. Yeah.
So how has this, so you spend a lot of time at the restaurant, so you're not having to cook and make your meals at home, and is your wife joining you?
Yeah, we always have been kind of average plant-based, beans, rice, salads, casseroles, a lot of spinach, and a lot of
your children?
Vitamix smoothies, and three wonderful children, two of the three. The restaurant owner, Daniel, then I have a paleo son, Jacob, who's a lawyer, but as paleo as paleo gets.
I have a paleo daughter. We can make a little shit
right
out here.
And we honor him and we love him, and after a year, he's finally come in and eaten at Green Space because his girlfriend likes it. So that's what happens. Girlfriends like it, and they get the meat-eating guys in, and then they realize it's not so bad. It's also much better for their sexual performance.
Okay. Being there.
And then I have a 23-year-old daughter, Jessica, who's the head shoe buyer for Gucci in North America, lives in New York, and she's vegan, not the shoes, but the food.
Right.
You're right. The bottom line is I'm pretty light about what I eat. It's often a baked potato out the door for breakfast, actually. I think baked potatoes are awesome with a lot of resistant starch in them. They've gotten a bad rap. Lunch is usually left over from the restaurant, and dinner I'm eating something at the bar. Now, we still prepare some food. But Detroit has the largest Arabic population in the United States. We have the most Middle Eastern restaurants, which means every corner of every city, there's falafel, there's tabbouleh, there's hummus, there's baba ganoush. All these words people don't even know, mujadara, but it's vegetarian heaven to eat in Middle Eastern restaurants, except the oil's heavy. So I'm not a big fan of oil-doused food. So we have, actually, this plant-based group has a bunch of restaurants throughout the city, not just mine, that have dedicated menus that are actually plant-based, no added oil menus to comply with Pritikin, Ornish, Esselstyn kind of diet. So we're kind of like a haven. If anybody wants to visit and is on a cardiac-friendly diet, Detroit is the place right now.
It's good to know.
It's pretty interesting.
So how have you learned to combat the criticism from your peers?
I fight them. I don't fight my peers in the city. I fight, and I gotta say, I fight with love. I'm not an angry guy. But I have chosen to make my life public. I'm everywhere on Facebook, everywhere on Twitter, everywhere on Instagram. I'm talking dozens of times a day. I don't tweet out when I'm in the toilet. I tweet out scientific studies, new research, pictures of food, because I have amazing access to the amazing stuff going on in my restaurant, the colors, the smells. And I like that stuff. I've learned to like using social media as a promotional tool, as an educational tool, as a interactive tool. But I also feel compelled, the trend in the last couple of years that everything that involves fat has got to be good to you, that it's assumed that science has shown that adding fat to your diet. I never used to eat butter, but it looks so good on Time magazine. They say eat butter. I've now decided to add butter back in my diet. I never used to use coconut oil, but God, everybody else is. So there's no scientific data that taking your baseline diet and adding things in that you didn't previously use that are highly concentrated in saturated fat is good for you. I mean, that's all BS. You know, if we take individual scientific studies and we incorporate some of these components, yes, there's some science to. Yeah, there may be some science to butter, you know, but not adding butter. But if you're using butter, I mean, there are some, I'm aware of the data. So I've chosen, in my own town, my personal passion is healthy hospital food. And I tried inside. I was director of cardiac rehab at the largest hospital in Detroit for 10 years. And I was director of preventive cardiology for 3 years at an enormous hospital system in Detroit. Nobody gave a whit. Rip about the fact that the cafeteria was no different than, you know, a industrial cafeteria in generally. There was as much fried food, as much meat, processed meat, cheeses. You know, yes, there were some options, but they were far and few between, and they weren't priced differentially. I tried inside, didn't work. So my passion now has been to be obnoxious. I have the only physician in the world with a Facebook page dedicated to bad hospital food. And people around the world send me pictures of what their relatives are eating, and I post them. Since I don't care, I put the name of the hospital. If I can get the CEO's name, I'll put the CEO's name. It's called Banned Hospital Carcinogenic Food. It's mainly focused on bacon only because the World Health Organization has a lot. You know, yes, there's a whole diversity of dietary ranges that support human health, and Maasai warriors to, you know, to Papua New Guinea vegans, but, or near vegans. But nonetheless, when science has, you know, we used to think smoking was good when Dr. Green was examining me in my crib, and now it's conventional to ban smoking from medical centers and everywhere else. We're in the midst of that painful transition, so I'm trying to move it quicker. So we have a Wendy's hospital, Wendy's restaurant in the middle of our university hospital that I'm a full professor at. And I mean, that's intolerable, and they just renewed the lease, which when I found that out, I went ballistic. So I, as often as I can, I embarrass them in social media, and I tag every news agency in Detroit as every day. That may seem like I will celebrate the day they break the lease and kick them out, which will be, you know, better for the city. You know, you can engage important people like Dr. David Ludwig and Dr. David Katz, who's on the right side of the equation, in my opinion, and Dr. Mark Hyman, and somewhere in the equation, I think he's got dropped on his head and got a little confused. But, you know, so...
Edit.
Yeah, I don't think he's on faculty here. But, you know, I write many blogs.
Right.
And that, and Huffington Post, Mind Body Green, One Green Planet. There's a new one that Arianna Huffington just started up called Thrive Global. And it's wonderful. I love writing blogs. And my blogs have 10 references to peer-reviewed PubMed documents. They don't reference Time magazine. No doctors should be writing blogs where when you hit the hyperlink, and this happens all the time. I read one this morning. The hyperlink is to Fortune. The hyperlink is to Essence magazine. Well, you know, read those while you're getting your hair done. But if you're writing as a physician, the hyperlink should be to studies. And mine always are. I finished one yesterday, 7 things that happen to your body with one fatty meal. Because there is a brand new study, but older data too. Your blood gets thicker. Your testosterone goes down, your arteries deteriorate, you become insulin resistant. A few other, like, not good things can be measured within an hour or two of a large fatty meal, whether it's butter or coconut oil. I don't think the public knows that, so I'm very fortunate,
I feel,
to have a platform, to put that out. And sure, it engenders, you know, there's an amazing Paleo Strong group on Twitter that can identify the 5 or 8 of us that are vocal and challenge them, but I go right at them.
Do you sleep at night?
I do. I used to not. I used to get up at 4 in the morning to work out. And I have embraced high-intensity interval training and, you know, short Tabata workouts and shorter yoga flows. I think you should be able to buy a yoga class by the 15 minutes. Nobody needs to do 60 minutes, you know, necessarily. I'm looking for power meditation when I can meditate for a minute. No, I do 12-minute meditation.
Is this ADHD or is this because you think you can?
It's a full schedule and it's science. If Dr. Okay. Tabata showed you can improve your fitness with 8 minutes as much as 45 minutes, and it has been verified by, blanking on the name, McMaster in Hamilton, Ontario for a minute, but Kabbalah is the name. You know, why not embrace the change? So I'll do hour-long workouts on occasion. But I actually now I'm in bed seven and a half hours, and I'm usually pretty out. Sometimes that's magnesium and valerian and chamomile-induced or Cabernet-induced. But I do sleep. So part of it is I actually enjoy what I'm doing so much. I enjoy the diversity. The last little piece of my life, and I don't usually speak about it, but I've been involved as an expert witness in medical malpractice cases for 25 years. And I'm still fascinated by it. I'm fascinated by our legal system, having no lawyers in the family until my son graduated law school. I'm fascinated by juries, the whole process of lay people trying to decide sophisticated medical issues. You know, the opportunity is, you know, it's another place to speak and have influence, generally supporting doctors, but on occasion working with the families of people that are, particularly in the cath lab, a lot of bad stuff happens. You know, I could write seven awful things that could happen to you in the cath lab that nobody tells you, but I don't write that kind of blog. But, you know, there, as a guy who's done thousands and thousands, I respect the fact on any given day, any single patient can go down the tubes, you know, in front of your eyes. So, I have this mix of, I've trained very aggressively, but we're far better to emphasize natural, conservative. You know, the body's ability to reverse disease needs to be taught. It's just not very profitable, but it's wonderful and remarkable. You know, the best example, if you interview Dr. Greger, but he explains it better than anybody else, it explains how nutrition heals and how lifestyle medicine heals is, you know, if you bang your shin and you got a big bruise, it will naturally heal up. But if, you know, three times a day you keep rebanging your shin, it's never going to heal and it's going to fester and worsen. And that's what bad food does 3-4 times a day. And, you know, that's the miracle of within a week of replacing your diet and filling it with nutrient-dense, plant-based, low-processed food. I mean, you stop banging your shin and things start to heal quickly. People feel better quickly.
What's next for you? What do you see yourself doing in the next 10
well,
years?
Well, given what's going on in politics, I think now I can run for president since anything can be in the closet and you can still get there. It's not without goals. I need to maintain this restaurant and we have a food line and that's actually, using my physician status, a restaurant, and my passion for nutrition as medicine to create a restaurant-based carryout line, then a Detroit-based carryout line, then a national carryout line of super healthy foods. That's, you know, a project that's underway, but it'll be a while before that, you know, sees that happen. That's just a combination of everything. People should be able to walk into a Publix or a Whole Foods or a, you know, other chain, Time and the rest, and really walk out, not just with better than average food, but really healing food, you know, with spices that are known to be anti-inflammatory, without additives, and in my case, without added oil. In my own life, if I have some oil, I don't care because I'm very fortunate to be very healthy and have no real issues. But for an adult diabetic, for an overweight person, for a heart patient, I want to create a food line that is, you know, right there and use the medical, you know, the impact of being a medical doctor as opposed to just coming from a Campbell's or Hunt's or something. So that would be a great success to see happen. And a TV show and a podcast and maybe a movie.
Ooh. And what would this movie be about?
Probably life trans. I would love, you know, Forks Over Knives was an incredible impact. We could do Detroit version. And it's kind of become, with the drop in price, to create high-quality digital impactful stuff. We could do that right in our city. Detroit's really become, and again, I'm not the mayor of Detroit, but when they list the top 10 vegan cities in the world, they include Detroit now. Whoa, and I think that's a little oversell. Top 10 in the United States, yeah, that's appropriate. So we've got a lot of good stuff going on, so always happy to promote hometown.
Well, good luck with everything.
Thank you.
So you're speaking here this weekend. How do you hope to inspire your peers or your constituents that you'll be speaking to?
And I'm glad we came back to that because, you know, I don't mean to go off on all these tangents, although they're probably entertaining. But, you know, this program and the people within it and Dr. Pamela Smith and the whole group, Dr. Mark Houston, have had an enormous impact on my career and my educational energy. You know, I go and surf PubMed for new stuff with much more enthusiasm. Truly, I was part of this came about, and am I ADHD? Sure. My mom could have told you that when I was three, and I had
breakfast. I could have told you that after two minutes.
I had breakfast with her this morning. My blessed mother, who's in the queen of workouts at age 84 in southern Florida. But, you know, you would ask me 7 years ago in cardiology, I mean, aspirin, statin, ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, stent. I mean, that's cardiologist menu. Stress test, echo, nuclear Holter. And all those are wonderful. I mean, it's never CoQ10. It's not even vitamin D, God forbid magnesium, and let alone getting into berberines and bergamots and, you know, green teas and all the rest. You know, it's this program has made my medical passion. You know, I'm going to retire when I guess I fall over my desk or something because it's so interesting. And you know, the drive to keep up, the drive to learn something new, and yeah, I can tell you two, three things I've learned about, you know, nutraceuticals in the last few months that, you know, I can immediately, I've got this lab called my patients and they've got problems and they need, you know, hopefully natural solutions. So there seems to be at least one report that ginkgo biloba lowers lipoprotein A, and I've got dozens and dozens of patients with high lipoprotein A, and I think it's good to get it down. I don't know that for sure. So just that's little kernel. And this program, it gets thanks for that. So, I, you know, sometimes I just feel like what we're doing now, I'm more than happy to be a booster of the educational opportunity and the quality of the education. I'm speaking about the natural treatment of arrhythmia, which is probably the most disappointing and frustrating of all topics. I'd rather talk about reversal of atherosclerosis, treatment of hyperlipidemias, treatment of sleep, weight, reversal of diabetes, all those things are easier and more gratifying. Arrhythmias are tough little suckers. And talking a little bit about cardiac testing. But really, I mean, Mark Houston is one of the brightest, most amazing, you know, physicians in the United States, and has had a major, major, major impact on me. And so I'm just grateful. I really am. You know, and grateful you got to give back.
So you've mentioned Pam Smith, you've mentioned Mark Houston. Yeah. So clearly they've been mentors to you through
right.
your transition. I'm sure you've been a mentor to your students as well. In your personal life, do you have any people that you seek mentorship from?
You know, I veer, that's a good question. And probably, well, those that I trained with even long ago, I mentioned the name Dr. James Willerson, one of the leading scientific lights in cardiovascular physiology, and we still once in a while, I'll email him. I don't know how many of his, you know, graduates from 30 years later randomly just shoot him an email. Hey, Jim, how you doing? And I lost the mentor that was my cath lab mentor, Dr. Jeffrey Hartzer in Kansas City, passed away about 4 years ago. It was very clear. I mean, I maintained the contact afterwards. Those were remained big influences. Actually, you know, I read outside of medicine, and I read some in business, marketing, anti-aging. So there's a physician named Peter Diamandis on the West Coast. I don't know if he lives in L.A. or San Francisco because he's got businesses, 20 businesses, including mining asteroids in space and shooting SpaceX modules up. But he speaks a lot about the future of technology in general, the future of medicine, the future of longevity. I mean, I think anti-aging, whether restricted to cardiology or whether extended to just aging in general, is fascinating. So he's become books called Bold and a podcast that he does, and I've had the opportunity to meet him a number of times. Great TED Talks. So, yeah, you know, it's kind of via digital media, very influential, sort of like Tony Robbins, but with a tremendous scientific bent. I mean, he's been picked as one of the top 50 smartest advisors, futurists, and it's been very interesting to watch that. You know, a whole group of fellow physicians and medical people around the country that are just stepping out. And, you know, whether it's plant-based nutrition, whether it's integrative medicine, using social media to extend their reach, even the diversity. Dr. Jack Wolfson, who went through this program, is in Scottsdale, Arizona, or Paradise Valley, right by Scottsdale, who is known as the paleo cardiologist and has a book, The Paleo Cardiologist. You know, obviously a slightly different orientation on how to achieve results, and he does achieve results. And we're going to lecture together in Toronto in a few weeks, and are very friendly terms, and we recognize, as I said, there's Maasai warriors and there's people living in the jungle eating plants all day long, and there may be more than one path to health, but we got to always bring it back to the science and what do human studies show, which are more in the plant-based world than any other. But yeah, so I mean, I honor people like that that are truly, you know, reminding people that lifestyle medicine is the core of all good health, and it may not address all human needs. There's lifestyle medicine and surgery and prescription drugs and other things, but those people inspire me to keep going.
If you weren't doing what you're doing, if you weren't a cardiologist and a vegan restaurateur, what do you think you would be doing?
Running a furniture chain. That was the family
business.
Right,
the family business.
Family business, yeah. I love, my father's passed away, but of a medical mishap in Southern Florida 8 years ago. He was a great man, and he built a very big business, which my sister has built bigger, but it would have been a joy to work with him most days.
What did your parents think of your vegan lifestyle?
Well, actually, they were part of it. My mother. My father was not at all a bad guy, but it usually is, you know, the mother of the house. They went down to the Pritikin Center, and I think they went to California in the beginning, but then it moved to South Beach. And I can kind of remember, I was just starting college, maybe it was 35 years ago or something like that, and nearly 40, and, you know, all of a sudden the salt shaker's gone, and then the oil, because Pritikin's really big on low salt, and then the oil bottle kind of is off the counter, and then there's beans and everything, so, you know, they got it, and then my mom, who was in charge of cooking, really embraced. She's 98%, you know, she's out at a restaurant, she'll have a piece of fish if needed. But she's embraced amazing cooking. So, you know, that influenced all of us. And he needed it. He had a few extra pounds on him and had a bit of coronary disease, so he benefited from all that. So no problem there. I mean, many people tell me, if your father could see what you're doing in this crazy restaurant, he'd just smile nonstop because it's, I mean, I offended all my partners years ago and, because I said, we're a retail business. Our practice is a retail business. They're called customers, and we need to have customer satisfaction surveys. You know, that was 25 years ago, and they actually whooped my rear for having that approach. And I wasn't a visionary. I mean, it's not like I'm taking any credit. That's become more common. And, of course, hospitals speak that language 100%. And, you know, and it just seems obvious. These people need to walk out of here happy and spread the good word and come back happy. So, you know, we're selling in medicine, and we're selling good stuff. We're, you know, we're selling enthusiasm for healthy lifestyles and, you know, and energy and avoiding hospitals and bad places like that. So I'm interested. I'm interested in media. I just shot my first infomercial for an organic superfood, grown American superfood containing 30 organic fruits and vegetables. Did that in a studio in New York City last week. I mean, I don't mind doing that because that's not a donut, and that's not soda pop, and that's not a French fry, and somebody's going to pick up something that's going to get some more nutrients in them, and I'm cool with that. So, fun stuff.
So, I'm just wondering, have you had any fellow cardiologists that you, because of their own personal health issue, have called you and said, okay, I need to change my life, and I need to change my practice?
Yeah, on occasion, not very often. They're still suspicious. You know, cardiology has been a good way to generate a lifestyle and an income, and it's fun and it's exciting, and that's changed quite a bit, but it remains. Nobody needs to feel sorry for cardiologists or cardiac surgeons. It's not the days of 20 years ago. But I think, you know, they're on a treadmill and they're working, and I saw it too. I kind of keep seeing more people per day if you wanted to try and maintain your practice flow to pay your overhead. The overhead doesn't go down just because reimbursement goes down. And it's taxing, and they're getting tired. So I don't think they have time to think about it. I mean, they see me out there. But it does. I didn't get here without, you know, I took, you know, several years of weekends and traveling the country with this, you know, great MMI teaching, you know, organization and taking tests. So you've got to put the effort in. It just isn't going to pop open, and you have the opportunity. It's not often that that actually happens. Physicians, cardiologists, pretty rarely. There's one in town, very prominent cardiologist with very genetically driven cholesterol disorder who will, what's that thing you told me about? And what's that supplement I heard you talk about? And so, he's bright enough to realize that, you know, you've got to be open-minded, not so open-minded that your brains fall out, and my brains haven't fallen out yet. So, I mean, I wish I could reach more of them. I mean, we've talked, Dr. Jack Wolfson and I have talked about internet-based, even if it's a brief training course on integrative cardiology, you know, no certification, just an exposure. This is all you could learn and could be doing and could be helping, or for your own health. Some, you know, because this is a big bite to do the whole program. It's worth it, but not
so
everybody.
So for physicians, not necessarily cardiologists who are listening or watching, that are considering crossing the threshold, what words of inspiration or advice might you give them?
As I say, I go back to that toolbox. It's made practice so much more fun. It's made it so much more mentally stimulating. I literally tell my wife 2-3 times a day by text or whatever before I get home, my brain is hurting. You know, it's just, I'm looking at 5 times more data per patient. I'm spending more time. I've got, you know, 5 times more therapeutic choices. And I'm trying to do the best thing, of course, and come up, you know, is it statin? Is it Reggie's Rice? Is it, you know, 15 other things I have in my office that they could walk out of there with, on top of lifestyle, on top of some educational material. And it's the right thing to do, and probably I haven't thought of a better way to digitize it all or, you know, formulate it. I still like patient-doctor interaction and having the impact, but it's worth it. It's worth it for the joy. It's worth it for the response and healing and feedback that they get. And they're just people. I mean, many doctors are doing the best they can and doing wonderful work, and they're helping people, but there are patients looking for more or that are getting tired of waiting rooms or getting tired of seeing, no disrespect, physician assistant nurse practitioners at my old cardiology practices to actually see it. They haven't added any cardiologists. They've added extenders, and they're capable and wonderful people. There's no disrespect there. But sometimes patients just want to hug their cardiologist that put their stent in, and it's can be a once-a-year event. I mean, you get to call me anytime. You're in my office talking to me about what's going on. And, you know, is it a model that's scalable? I'm not sure it is. But is there a place for the people that have the drive to do a program like this and have their special practice? We need more in Detroit. We need some primary care integrative physicians right now. They'd fill up 2 years, a year, without doubt.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kahn.